Hi, this is Graham and I do hope everyone's having a great day and welcome to the second part in this mini tutorial series covering getting better images with the Panasonic Lumix FZ200 camera. First of all, a big thank you to all that fed back on part one of this series. It gives me the encouragement to actually produce you more videos covering the FZ200, so thanks again for that. In today's video I want to cover shooting in low light and low contrast situations. Today we have a very overcast sky and actually rain is just about in the air, so it's very overcast and it's an ideal situation for taking things like Smithers Hall here, architectural interest. You don't have the bright sunshine casting shadows and also that gives you the extra problems of contrast and dynamic range. So an overcast situation is ideal for architectural shots, either standalone buildings like this or in city centres where the shadows are cast across the streets and you hardly get any detail at all in the shadow parts of the scene. It's also ideal for taking plant photography as this gives you a nice soft contrast lighting and that brings out the detail in all of the highlight parts of the plant. In bright sunlight these are very easily burned out and you lose all that detail. So I'll be showing you in this video how to set up to take low light situations and especially in these low contrast situations. First of all, I'll be looking at shooting plants and I found some wood anemones here and I actually started to shoot them using the FZ200. Because it's an overcast situation, I've actually moved up the white balance to a cloudy preset. That brightens up the scene by adding a slight amount of warmth. If you leave it in auto white balance, the camera will keep the subject cool. So I tend to prefer to use a cloudy white balance in this sort of situation. If you want to warm up the scene even further, move down to the shades position and that gives you a nice warm tone to your pictures and video. With the wood anemones, I've actually tried to do a focus pull using the FZ200. It's something I wasn't really aware of until it was pointed out to me on YouTube that there was a facility. In the manual movie mode, you can actually select manual focus by depressing the top control wheel while you're in video mode. And that enables you then to use the left and right navigation buttons to move the focal point. And you can use that to do an effective focus pull, as I'm showing you now in this video shot here at Smithers Hall. I first of all shot the anemones using just ordinary overcast light, but then I tried to add some brightness and warmth to the situation by using the inbuilt flash. You can use this to give you that extra bit of light, and if you find it overpowering you can actually reduce the flash power through the menu. When it comes down to taking pictures in extreme low light situations, I wish there was a magic setting you could apply to the FZ200 to allow you to create some good pictures and video. Unfortunately, the FZ200 doesn't behave too well in low light situations. If you try to use the ISO to brighten the picture by moving the ISO to a higher number, you'll find that you increase the image noise. This camera seems to have a plateau around about ISO 400. Go beyond ISO 400 and the image quality drops off quite severely. I'm illustrating that now in this series of shots I've taken of the hall behind me. I've started with ISO 100 and then increased through 2, 4, 8, 16, up to 3200. And you can see up to ISO 400 you can probably use the images, but beyond ISO 400 the noise that's been introduced by the electronics is giving a really degraded picture. So you must use the camera below ISO 400 if you want to get the best pictures you can with this camera. So that doesn't preclude you from taking long time exposure shots. It just means you have to be a bit more creative in how you take those shots, either by resting the camera on a firm surface or preferably using a tripod. I normally carry a very small travel tripod in my bag. Even if I'm only using a small carry bag, I'll put this little tripod in there. Even with the inbuilt image stabilization of the camera, with the wide angle setting you can probably use exposures of about a 1/25th of a second and create some decent pictures. However, if you start to put telephoto onto this, the subject movement and your hand movement will preclude you from getting sharp images. So it's better to use a tripod if you're going to be using anything more than say x4 or x8 zoom with this camera in these low light situations. If you can't take a tripod into the scene, like in the hall behind, they don't allow you to use tripods in the hall for taking photographs, you might be able to get away with using a monopod. So a small monopod is all you need just to be able to stabilize the camera from up and down movement. You've still got the side-to-side movement, but you can probably control that a little bit better because you're now holding the camera a little bit more rigid. Ideally, all video should be shot from a tripod. If you're going to handhold video, you'll notice that the codec just can't hold the resolution. It has to drop resolution in order to pack the amount of pixels that are changing in the scene. So you'll end up with a scene which has got a lot more or less resolution than one that's been mounted on a tripod. As I mentioned previously, you can use the preset white balance controls to warm up the scene. You'll probably find that you can use the cloudy preset or the shade preset, and that adds that extra bit of yellow to the scene, and that warms up the situation rather than leaving the scene cold as the auto white balance would dictate. So those are some hints and tips that you might find useful if you're shooting low light situations, or particularly these low contrast ones. There is some argument for setting the contrast to +2 in the natural profile when you're shooting in these overcast conditions, as naturally there is very little contrast in the subject, so you might want to introduce that in the JPEG processing by going to a +2 contrast in the actual natural photo style. I've employed that today to try and see if that works for me, and let's see what you think about that situation. Well, that's it for this video. Thanks very much for watching, and I do hope you found that interesting. You did learn something along the way. In the final part of the series, I'll be looking at the compositional aspects of photos, how to improve your photographic composition. We won't be talking too many camera specifics, but we'll be looking at how to use the camera, changing your viewpoint, aligning your subject slightly differently to give your pictures more of an impact. So hopefully in the final video we'll be able to pull everything together, from the camera specifics about taking photographs, using the right ISO, using the right photo style, and then add that with the photographic compositional elements, and you will be creating some fantastic pictures. Look forward to bringing you that video. Until then, thanks for watching, and goodbye for now.